Today we'll talk about Eugene Kingman, a landscape artist, a muralist, an adopted Nebraskan, and a man for the captivating history. And we'll talk about the journey of one of his most important murals. Eugene Kingman was a Renaissance man, and he did everything. He was born in Rhode Island in 1909, and all of his formal education was in New England. But we'll see how he was transformed into an artist of Nebraska, Oklahoma, the West, and the Southwest. All of his formal education was in New England. But we'll see how he was He grew up in a family where hard work, creativity, art, and music were a part of life. Young Gene was always interested in both art and science and how the two could work together. He considered studying medicine, he loved geology and nature, but he had a passion for drawing and painting. And people recognized his talent. While he was in high school, he took classes near his home at the prestigious Rhode Island School of Design. He also spent a year after high school painting at Harvard's Waldron Museum. In the late 1920s, he packed up his art supplies and went to Yale, where he majored in geology. This geology student quickly put his art skills to work and became the art editor of the Yale Record, the campus humor magazine founded in 1872. In this cartoon, he satirizes campus changes as beloved historic buildings are pushed out to sea and new buildings spread across the horizon. While he was in college one summer, his father and uncle packed up their families and traveled west on a journey to see the country. I don't know how many of you took family vacations in the station wagon as kids, but this was the rough and tumble days of the early automobile, and the Kingmans visited 10 national parks that summer. For Gene Kingman, it was a life-changing trip. He was moved by everything he saw. The plains, the west, the southwest, the northwest, and he wanted to paint it all. From that trip on, Gene Kingman headed west to paint as often as he could, but he was still in college. He returned to Yale and submitted several of his paintings from that summer of travel to a competition sponsored nationwide by the National Park Service. He won the competition. As a college junior, he was commissioned by Horace M. Albright, the famous conservationist and the second director of the National Park Service, to paint scenes in 7 of the parks. The 21-year-old geology student had his paintings sent to an exposition in Paris in 1931. I don't know if they're still hanging there, but in recent administrations, the Secretary of the Department of the Interior hung the Kingman paintings of Old Faithful and the Grand Tetons in his office. In 1932, Kingman graduated with a Bachelor of Arts in Geology. He had a fascination with earth and nature and rocks. Part of that might have been influenced by his brother-in-law, Wallace Atwood, who was a nationally known geologist and the director of the Chicago Academy of Sciences. If you've ever gone to the Atwood Planetarium in Chicago, you might be familiar with the Atwood Celestial Sphere. He created it in 1913. It was the first time a planetarium ever rotated around the audience. Before that, the people had to turn around inside these domes. In 1934, Kingman, who was by then a graduate MFA student at Yale, had a chance to go with Wally Atwood on a National Geographic assignment. The two men were assigned to work on an article to interpret through geology, geography, and painting how Crater Lake and the Yosemite Valley developed. We're going to see a remarkable series of paintings of the exact same scene as the two imagine how the earth evolved. This is the same scene 7 million years later. Kingman said their idea was to take one scene and go back millions of years in research. A few million years later, Kingman said while they wrote the story, and I painted the pictures as we visualized them for each period. The National Geographic may have been hesitant to have a 25-year-old artist paint the story, but the magazine must have been delighted with the results. It was a wonderful experience for Kingman, who saw art and science working together. Kingman's 13 paintings were in the National Geographic of March of 1937. Kingman received his Master of Fine Arts from Yale, specializing in mural painting, and he began teaching mural painting and lithography at the Rhode Island School of Design. Teaching and painting when he wasn't too busy drawing. He was very busy. He won a major commission in a competition sponsored by the United States Treasury Art Project to create murals at 3 U.S. post offices. The New Deal Arts Program was a way to create art in public buildings by promising artists. The murals are in Maryland, Wyoming, and Rhode Island. All three murals are still hanging in those post offices. But his heart was in the West. Kingman had become an early expert in Western American art history. He studied the artists and their styles of painting. Let's take a brief look at those early artists. America's West was first recorded in the 1800s by artists like George Catlin, Carl Bodmer, Alfred Jacob Miller, and Carl Bierstadt. They wanted to get people excited about exploring the western part of our country. This country of ours was untamed and unsettled. There were stories to tell that had never been told before, scenes no one had ever imagined. These painters let us see parts of America we did not yet understand. Kingman said that Bierstadt had devoted his life to painting the massive beauty of the Western landscape. You can see the difference between these early Western artists and the group who developed in the 1930s and 40s called the Regionalists. The best known of these Regionalist artists include Grant Wood, John Stuart Curry, and Kingman's good friend, Thomas Hart Benton. By this time in our country, Americans had been to the West, settled it, and seen the country in between. Regionalism was about a simpler, settled life. We can see how playful the lines are. It almost seems hard to find a straight line in a regionalist painting. This painting is quiet. It invites warmth rather than awe. And we notice the same curving, undulating lines. Regionalists were not painting what Kingman called the massive beauty of Bierstadt, but stories of their country that were less grand and more intimate. They weren't looking at a majesty we had never seen, but painting what they knew. They were giving us images of their own Midwest, small towns, and rural scenes. This is the Baptism of Kansas, and it's at the Whitney Museum in New York. He painted this in 1928, but it was from something he saw when he was a teenager in 1915. There was a terrible drought, and there was no water for baptisms. So they used horse troughs. And you see up there the raven and the dove, God's messengers. This is another Curry. Again, the curving lines and the really close-up look at it. Curry often painted scenes from his life in Kansas and Wisconsin. This is the Hailstorm by Thomas Hart Benton. Benton and Gene Kingman both painted a lot of murals and made lithographs, probably to make their art available to a wider audience. Thomas Hart course, there's the Missouri mule that every farmer had. And when he first painted this, he didn't have that second farmer in the background. And he went back and looked at it and said, no, some respecting farmer would leave an animal in the field and run. So he added the second farmer to it. Gene Kingman painted in this new style, but he did not want to be called a regionalist. Yet look at his subjects, his love of the land and the people. He was a regionalist. Kingman told his daughter that he and Tom Benton used to laugh about the way the arts community always wanted to categorize paintings and artists. I just paint what I like. Wherever he lived or traveled in the country, he was inspired by the land. And while we could feel its grandeur, there was a familiarity about it. Look at the differences between the regionalist style and those early Western painters. When Bierstadt painted in the Sierra Nevada, the colors were subtle, and its scale, its very distant perspective, were humbled by the scale of the mountains. When Kingman painted the mountains, the color was less muted and more intimate. We're closer to it, and the scale is smaller, like the regionalists. Now let's go back to Kingman's post-college life in the 1930s. He was still teaching at the Rhode Island School of Design, and as he traveled, he continued to draw and paint. In 1938, Kingman visited Mesa Verde National Park. Now what I want to replace this with is that beautiful oil painting that's over there at Mesa Verde. I've never seen it before. That is spectacular. He got a tour of the park from a beautiful park ranger named Elizabeth Yellen. Benny was a museum assistant and an anthropologist with a master's degree. They were married in 1939, and a few days later, Gene and Betty started their jobs together at the Philbrook Museum of Art in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Gene as the first director and Betty as the assistant director. This Italian Renaissance building was given to the city of Tulsa in 1938. So Kingman was handed this beautiful building and a few collections of art and was asked to create an art museum. He got to work. And as art began filling the galleries, Kingman started looking at the experience of the museum goer. He added other offerings to draw people in the doors, like art classes, tours for the public and for school children. He also began to develop some new and innovative ideas into museum exhibits and interpretive designs. This was a turning point in his life. In just 3 years, the Philbrook became a popular cultural institution for the Tulsa community. But World War II had started a few years earlier, and in 1942, Kingman joined the Army and was assigned to Washington, D.C. There, his unusual combination of skills in geology, map making, art, and exhibit design made him the perfect choice for a critical role as Chief of Presentations for the Office of Strategic Services. 5 years later, the OSS was reorganized and renamed the Central Intelligence Agency. This is a Kingman map created for the OSS. His work was used by the Army, Navy, State Department, Treasury, and the Office of War Intelligence. Another renowned Yale graduate working with the OSS was Richard E. Harrison, one of the most prominent map makers this country has ever had. During any war, but especially in World War II, maps became a lifeline of information for everyone in the country as people talked about the latest military campaign and where troops might be. Harrison was a cartographer on the staff of Fortune magazine and created maps for Time, Life, and a number of government agencies. He and Kingman probably when Harrison was a geographic consultant for the OSS. What made Harrison so important was the way he drew maps. When the New York Times wrote about him, they noted what they called his distinctive hill shading. It creates a page that appears three-dimensional. Using different maps from different sources, he could create new projections to fit his maps for whatever purpose was needed. It helped him to make military maps for soldiers in the field, and his maps helped to train pilots to understand regions that had not yet been photographed by air. And it helped Americans to get a better perspective of geography and the relationship between various countries, and could help them understand why a president might want to send troops to Iceland. After World War II ended, Eugene Kingman and Richard Eads Harrison came together again to work on a very large map for the New York Times. In 1946, World War II ended, and Kingman had two wonderful post-war opportunities. One was an invitation to become the second director of the Joslin Memorial, as it was called then, in Omaha. He accepted. The second was when Arthur Hayes Sulzberg, publisher of the New York Times, invited Eugene Kingman and Richard Eads Harrison to create a mural for the lobby of the New York Times headquarters. Kingman and Harrison were the perfect match for this job. Harrison provided the original map, and Kingman painted the mural. So when Kingman began his work at Joslin in 1946, with the blessing of his new employers, he also took some space in the galleries to paint the mural. This 7-foot by 21-foot mural took a couple of years to come together. In 1948, Kingman took it to New York and installed it in the lobby. It was after the war. What Arthur Sulzberger wanted when he commissioned the New York Times mural was a big view of our world. He wanted each person who saw this art to have a sense that we are all sharing a piece of this earth. And he asked Kingman for a view of the world as it might have been seen from space. We can't imagine the number of people who saw this painting. People coming to the paper for interviews, meetings with editorial boards, famous authors, diplomats, newsmakers, and all of those who worked at the New York Times walked past it every day. The reporters, the staff, the executives, every one of them came through the doors of that lobby and saw this painting. This was painted 11 years before the first satellite went into space. It was before we knew what the Earth really looked like from above. But Kingman, with his unique background, painted a world for us that is incredibly accurate. If you see the mural up close, you'll see red dots on certain cities. We don't know exactly what they were, but we guess that they are cities that were key to the New York Times. New York, Paris, Tokyo, London, they were all marked on the map with a red dot, and Omaha. Kingman had to include his new home with a red dot that probably would have never been noticed by the casual viewer, but he knew it was there. And Sulzberger asked him to include on the mural a line of poetry. Every day is a fresh beginning. Every morn is the world made new. He wanted something inspiring for his staff and visitors, something that as they gazed at this remarkable view of the world, encouraged them that no matter how difficult things have become in our world or in our own lives, today really is a fresh start. The mural hung in the lobby of the Times for more than 40 years and was a familiar part of the landscape of the building and of New York City. over the years, the painting suffered to exposure from what I am guessing was constant cigarette and cigar smoke, and it suffered from the passage of time. In the late 1980s, during the remodeling, the mural was taken down, and for more than 25 years, this painting was rolled up in storage. They would often talk about it and wonder what they should do with this great painting. In this photo, taken in 2006, they took it out to check its condition. In 2014, some women from Omaha, including Julie Cobb, Julie Riley, and Lynn Wallen-Zingenheim, got in touch with Kingman's two daughters and worked with the New York Times to return the mural back to Omaha. The Times donated the mural to the Jocelyn Castle Trust, the wonderful cultural center in Omaha, housed in Sarah and George Jocelyn's old home. The mural arrived in Nebraska in May of 2014. Over the next 2 years, more than 100 donors contributed, and the mural was restored at the Ford Conservation Center by Kenneth Bay, the head of paintings conservation. Kenneth knew that his biggest challenge would be the smoke and grime on the mural. And this is exactly the way Kenneth, I would stop in periodically. He did this on his hands and knees with a big old Q-tip there, cleaning it square inch by square inch. What looked like browns and grays were really underneath vibrant blues and greens. And you can see here where the right side has not yet been cleaned and the left side is a different looking piece of art. Then we had to find the right place to hang. We wanted it in a permanent spot, in a place that didn't charge admission, a building open to the public long hours, and a location with a 21-foot-long empty space in its galleries. That is hard to find. In June of 2016, the restored mural was hung in the atrium of the main bridge of the Omaha Public Library downtown. I hope you can stop in and see it. The Dale Clark branch of the library is at 15th and Douglas Streets, just inside the 15th Street door. Talk about the right location. The mural fit the spot with about an inch to spare. I think Kenneth may have had a few heart attacks somewhere along the way. There was very, very little room. It was exactly the right size. It's a beautiful piece, not only colorful, but a wonder of precision and skill in map making and art. And the poem is inspiring too. Eugene Kingman would probably be elated to think of his New York Times mural back in the city where he created it. And he created it in Omaha because he met with Paul Grummond, who asked Kingman if he wanted to be the next director of Jocelyn. Grummond had been the first director of the Jocelyn Memorial. He had done it for 15 years and he wanted to retire. Kingman was thrilled to go back to the Midwest and moved his family to Omaha to become Jocelyn's curator. The next year, as planned, when Grummond retired, Kingman became the second director of the museum. He would go on to become the longest serving director in Jocelyn's history. From the time it opened in 1931, Jocelyn was much more than beautiful artworks and musical concerts. There was a Conestoga wagon in the main floral court. Art museums often have artifacts as well as art. Eugene Kingman's major talent for display and exhibits, his creative energy and his ideas for making Jocelyn a cultural center were what drew Grummond's interest in him. One of his successors at the museum, former director Graham Beale, wrote that Kingman was a painter of considerable skill and a pioneer in Western American art history. He said that Kingman pictured Jocelyn as the Smithsonian of Omaha, a full-blown center for the arts and sciences, embracing all aspects of Kingman endeavor. Kingman created exhibits of history and culture in the region. He painted panoramas, he set up period rooms. Beale said that Kingman embedded art and artifacts within displays that discussed broader cultural conditions, and that contextualizing, Beale said, was well in advance of its time. One exhibit called Life on the Prairie drew national attention and an invitation from the Smithsonian asking him to be a consultant on Smithsonian exhibits, something he did for many years. Back then, we didn't have a lot of museums in Omaha. There was no Durham Museum, and many of us had no awareness of preserving our history. So if the Smithsonian was considered the nation's attic, Kingman may just be Omaha's attic. According to Graham Beale's book, Kingman saved a lot of our history and culture that would have been lost. Beale writes that even though Kingman never intended to exhibit things, he accepted historic items that people wanted to donate to Jocelyn. He said thousands of objects that were stored there for decades and in recent years were transferred to a number of regional history museums. Graham Beale also writes that Kingman personally salvaged interiors of old mansions that were being demolished, and in 1966 stood in the archway of the main entrance of Omaha's old post office building, defying the wrecking ball until guaranteed its safety. The post office was torn down in 1966, but its demise sparked an interest in historic preservation. And Kingman and William Utley, the dean at UNO, became the core founders of Landmarks, Inc., which has evolved into Restoration Exchange Omaha, an organization dedicated to preserving our historic resources. From the moment he arrived in Nebraska, Kingman fell head over heels in love with the people, the plains, the barns, the fields, the life of Nebraska. When he wasn't coming up with new ways to attract people to Jocelyn or saving historic artifacts, planning new exhibits, or giving talks, Kingman was a prolific painter. He developed a knack for painting Nebraska cornfields. He loved what he called the distinctive character of Nebraska, but his time for painting was pretty limited, so his working radius was close to home. He painted dozens of local scenes over the years, and his daughters say that weekend picnics would take them out to farms west of Omaha. One of his favorite spots was Davis Farm, way out beyond the edge of town at 120th Street. The 220-acre Davis Farm is gone now, and in its place are stores, office buildings, and the Miracle Hills Golf Course. Dr. John Davis grew up on that farm and told me he remembered as a young man seeing Kingman sitting on the dirt road that was 120th Street painting his family farm. This painting now hangs over the fireplace in the living room of the governor's mansion in Lincoln. He also loved to paint near the intersection of Blondo and 132nd Street, then known as 10 Mile Road. He would stop on the road in late afternoon, pull out his brushes, and begin to paint. Once he saw a great-looking tractor he wanted to paint with a farmhouse in the distance, he sat up and was working when a farmer pulled up deep behind him. "Oh," said the farmer, "you're just a painter. I thought you were going to strip the spark plugs off my tractor." In 1952, there was a show of his Nebraska paintings at the Providence Art Club in his hometown in Rhode Island. The show was a great success, and the Providence newspaper loved Kingman. They wrote that this New England native had been deeply influenced by the wide, rolling prairie country. In 1953, Kingman was convinced convinced to do a one-man show of his own works at Jocelyn. At the time, he wrote an artist statement saying, "This country has a distinctive character." And sounding a lot like a regionalist painter, he said, "It's expansive, yet human in all of its parts." In 1960, a local country club commissioned Gene to create a large landscape for their lobby. And he was asked to do a New England scene. "I'm New England," he said, "I'm not Nebraska." He remembered them objecting, saying the right thing for a country club would be a New England scene. "New England with a little bit of Nebraska." They reluctantly agreed, but said they would reserve final judgment. In the end, Gene painted what he wanted to all along, this Nebraska scene with a little bit of New England. Of course, they loved it and displayed it for years. One of Kingman's cornfield paintings that has a special place in my heart is a mural he painted on two walls of a stairway of his own house near Elmwood Park. After the Kingmans lived in Omaha a few years, his wife was frustrated because their young daughters left fingerprints on the walls going upstairs. Like a good muralist, he solved the problem by painting a mural up the staircase. No more fingerprints. This is the other view of the stairway mural. In 1987, 40 years and several others later, my husband and I moved into that house where we still live. We weren't sure what this incredible painting was, but the first thing we said to our very young children was, "Don't put your fingerprints on the mural." This is my favorite view of the mural because you can see the fence post that rises. He painted the light switch plate right into that fence post. Let me talk about Eugene Kingman's impact on the arts. When he became a Nebraskan, he became not just a leader in the community, but in the world of arts, and he was respected across the country. In 1954, he was asked to write an article for American Heritage magazine. It came out in December of that year, The Painters of the Plains. In it, he wrote about the same historic painters we have already mentioned, and he discussed their influence on American art. But the first painters that he mentioned were the Native Americans. The first traveling exhibit ever to leave Egypt with a large number of artifacts of King Tutankhamun started in 1961. It made brief stops in 18 cities in the U.S. and a few more in Canada before it spent 6 months at the New York World's Fair in 1964. During that time, I lived outside of Washington, D.C. and then Philadelphia, and King Tut did not come to either one of those cities. But the fourth stop on this historic tour was the Jocelyn Art Museum in Omaha, where the exhibit spent the entire month of May of 1962. Eugene Kingman was so respected that Jocelyn hosted the exhibition. Did anybody here see it as a kid? Mixie, you don't count. Oh, we did. A lot of times people will say, "Oh, my parents took me to see them." In 1968, Creighton University gave him an honorary doctorate, saying the cultural face of Omaha has changed dramatically in the past two decades, and one of the motivating forces behind this change has been Eugene Kingman. Eugene Kingman was a Renaissance man. A man with a sense of creating museum exhibits that could connect what we were seeing with our own lives, where we had been with where we are going. He was a man who understood and appreciated history and wanted to preserve Omaha's artifacts. What we received from Gene Kingman is still here at the Jocelyn Art Museum. It's scattered at history museums across the area, and it's in paintings which still hang in homes around the region. And now a highlight of that legacy is the mural at the Dale Clark Library downtown. I am happy to take any questions, but I wanted to thank the Jocelyn Castle Trust for accepting ownership of the mural from the New York Times. They have been a great partner for us. And in addition to restoring the mural, we've also created a curriculum for third and fourth graders, which is available free to any teacher. It can add a wonderful dimension to lessons in social studies, language arts, and fine arts. The teachers who created this curriculum have aligned it with the Nebraska Department of Education's academic content standards for social studies, English, language arts, and fine arts. The curriculum includes a kit for teachers, which contains a flash drive, a student version of this Kingman PowerPoint, a classroom poster, a teacher guide to the new curriculum, and as many student guides as a teacher needs. And if anyone's interested, you can see me or contact the Jocelyn Castle Trust directly. If you'd like to know more about Eugene Kingman and his work, his family has created a website at www.eugenekingman.com. Thank you very much.